So today I want to introduce our speaker. We have Dr. Amber Vinchesi-Vahl. She's an area vegetable crops advisor with the University of California Cooperative Extension, serving Colusa, Sutter, and Yuba counties. And today she's going to be speaking on vegetable IPM in the Sacramento Valley. So Amber, I'm going to go ahead and pass this over to you so you can go ahead and share your slides.
Thank you, Cheryl. Okay, so today I'm going to be talking about vegetable IPM in the Sacramento Valley. In the counties that I cover, we have just under 26,000 acres of processing tomatoes. That's the main vegetable crop in my area in Sutter and Colusa County, and we'll be adding some acreage to Yuba County for processing tomatoes in 2023. Processing tomatoes are the number four crop in both Colusa and Sutter counties and bring in over $100 million every year. And we also have over 4,000 acres of vegetable grown for seed. So this includes cucumbers, squash, watermelon is the biggest, onion, melon, and pumpkin as well. And then in Sutter and Yuba counties, we also grow fresh market musk melons, which are honeydew and cantaloupe. So just a little bit of background on the areas that I cover. So I want to start with an overview of IPM, or integrated pest management. This is an ecosystem-based strategy focusing on long-term prevention of pests and damage through a combination of techniques. These techniques can include biological control, cultural control, mechanical or physical control, and chemical control working together. Pesticides are used only after monitoring indicates that they are needed, and treatments are made with the goal of removing only the target organism. Materials are selected and applied in a manner that minimizes risks to human health, beneficial and non-target organisms, and to the environment. So today I'll start with quite a bit of information on processing tomatoes, since that's the main crop that I work with. We'll start with weed management, post-harvest pre-plant through after planting, and I'll talk a little bit about a cultivator trial that I conducted in 2020 and 2021. Then we'll move on to disease management, which is probably the main issue that I deal with in processing tomatoes, is soilborne fungal pathogens. And now we've also got two insect vector viruses that are becoming more of a problem for us. And then I'll move into and wrap up with a little bit on fresh market musk melons, focusing on insect management, but mainly on cucumber beetles. And all of the resources for this talk can be found with UCIPM in the pest management guidelines for tomatoes and cucurbits and from my own research. So we'll get right into integrated weed management of processing tomatoes. So for post-harvest and pre-plant weed management, crop rotation is a great cultural tool. Crop rotation can effectively reduce weed problems by changing the environment that favors a specific weed species, or by allowing methods to control weeds that you wouldn't be able to use in a tomato crop. For example, corn allows you to use herbicides to control nightshades, yellow nutsedge, and field bindweed that you wouldn't be able to use in tomato. Things like Yukon or dicamba or Sandia halosulfuron. So other useful rotational crops include wheat, cotton, rice, dry beans, onions, carrots, and safflower. We don't recommend rotating for weed control with other solanaceous crops, which are closely related to tomato, and these would include potatoes, peppers, and eggplant. Field preparation is also key. If you can, try to avoid fields with severe weed infestations. Avoid moving weed seeds into fields on equipment and clean before entering fields. This equipment sanitation is going to be a key management strategy for both weeds and for disease management in tomatoes. Deep tilling can reduce nightshade and nutsedge populations. And then pre-irrigation and rainfall that germinates nightshade species before planting, you can then control with cultivation or post-emergent herbicides. Continuing with post-harvest pre-plant, soil fumigation is an option. Metam sodium, metam potassium, these can provide control of many weeds and other soil-borne pests if this is an option for you. Leave enough time between fumigant applications and transplanting to prevent any phytotoxicity or crop injury to your tomato plants that you're planting the following spring. Herbicide applications made to fall or winter beds may allow for earlier plantings. Rainfall is necessary to break down those fall applied herbicides though, so that the following year's tomatoes will not be injured, similar to when you use soil fumigation. Perennial weeds like field bindweed and little mallow can be controlled post-harvest by irrigating and applying contact herbicides, though bindweed is pretty difficult to control. Some herbicides are best applied just before planting and then incorporated into the soil. This is a common practice for processing tomato growers. And the entire bed top can be treated, or band treatments can be applied over the seed line. Ban treatments reduce herbicide costs and risk of herbicide carryover to the next crop. And post-emergent weed treatment may also be necessary before planting to control any weeds that have already emerged close before you're going to transplant the tomatoes. So at planting weed management, planting dates. If you can manipulate the planting dates to take advantage of weed germination under different temperatures, this works well. For example, early plantings under cooler soil temperatures usually avoid barnyard grass competition during tomato seedling growth. And then cultivations can further reduce weed populations along the sides of the planted row. So cultivation is another option. And of course, transplanting, which gives the crop a growth advantage over weeds. And I just found out from a meeting on Monday that all processing tomatoes in the state of California are now transplanted. The last few direct seeded fields are now going into transplanting for the 2023 season. So after planting, cultural practices become very important. Try preventing weeds from going to seed so that they don't spread, keeping canal banks free of weeds, avoid moving weed seeds into the fields on equipment and cleaning equipment. This was, again, a management strategy for post-harvest as well. Keeping your bed tops dry with drip irrigation. Perennial weeds like field bindweed are likely to remain a problem with drip irrigation, but in general, by keeping the bed tops drier, less weeds are going to germinate on the soil surface. With furrow irrigation, maintaining alternate row irrigation prevents overly wet conditions. Cultivation and hand weeding, very standard practice. So mechanical cultivation close to the seed line, that's standard, reduces hand weeding needs later. And we now have options for in-row cultivation like finger weeders. And I'll go into these a little bit more when I talk about my project. Herbicides, post-emergent herbicides, always apply as directed on each side of the seed line and then immediately incorporate. Variable rate lay-by applications can also reduce herbicide cost with no loss in weed control or tomato yield. And this means that you're applying full rate in the furrow and a reduced rate next to the crop. So common weed problems for processing tomatoes in California include field bindweed, nightshades, nutsedge, and broom rape. And you can find more information on integrated weed management at the UCIPM website. So I want to talk a little bit about broom rape. This is a very kind of contentious subject. Broom rape is a root parasite. We have branched broom rape is the one we're most concerned about. We believe we've been able to eradicate the Egyptian broom rape from the field it was found in Yolo County. So broom rapes are root parasites that attach to the host below ground, and at high densities, they can greatly reduce yield or result in crop failure. We've seen up to 70% loss in tomato in other countries. Broom rape is an A-listed quarantine pest. It's a pest of known economic or environmental detriment that is present in limited distribution, and it allows for the possibility of eradication or successful containment. It's subject to state-enforced action involving eradication, quarantine, regulation, containment, rejection, or other holding action. So we do have branched broom rape in the Sacramento Valley. We don't have any current data on control of broom rape species with our currently California registered pesticides. But Brad Hansen, he's a cooperative extension weed specialist on campus, and his grad student, Matt Fatino, are working hard to try to figure out what we can get registered in California that would be successful at controlling broom rape. Currently, we're in the process of scouting, reporting, quarantine, and crop destruct. Our short-term goal is to minimize spread, but because it's crop destruct and quarantined and there's no crop insurance for this problem, not everyone reports it. So we might get to the point where we're going to be managing it instead of trying to eradicate it. So we're trying to develop mitigation approaches for if we get to that point. So I did an in-row cultivator trial in 2020 and 2021 with my colleague, Scott Stoddard. He's a vegetable crops advisor in Merced and Madera counties. So what we wanted to do was evaluate weed control, time, and costs of using mechanical and automated in-row cultivators as part of a conventional weed management program. So standard cultivation gets right along the side of the beds, but nothing gets right into that seed line to control weeds in between the tomato plants. So we compared in-row mechanical and robotic weeders to the grower standard practice of post-emergent herbicides like Rim Sulfuron or Matrix, and we had trial sites in Colusa and Merced County. So we used the Robovator, This is a robotic weeder that we borrowed from another cooperative extension weed specialist, Steve Fenimore in Salinas. And it's an automated weeder. It uses cameras to differentiate between the tomatoes and the weeds. So it has this vision technology. And then we use the finger weeder, which is a mechanical weeder that's gaining a lot of popularity in my area. It's a in-row mechanical weeder with interlocking rubber fingers. You can see in the picture on the left here. And those will pull up weeds within the plant row as well. And this was funded by the California Tomato Research Institute. So I have a couple of videos here. Hopefully they come through. So when we ran the Robovator in Colusa in 2020, you can see how well it worked. It opens around the tomato plants, and then as those blades are pulling up any weeds that would be within that plant row there. However, in 2021, we had some high winds right before we ran the Robovator, and the plants were flopped over. So we were not able to really, we kept trying to increase the buffer zone. We were having technological issues. And what happened was, because the Robovator is looking at the top of the plant, and if the top of the plant isn't in line with the stem, it's going to cut the stem. So you can see here, we had significant crop injury from the Robovator ripping up tomato plants. Luckily, my plots were very small, but this photo here is a photo of what the Robovator plots looked like about a week or two later. So Scott had similar issues in Merced after windy days as well, but it worked very well in 2020. Okay, and then I have a video from Scott of his finger weeder that they use, just to give you an example of what the finger weeder kind of looks like when it's running. You have a much smaller window of opportunity with the finger weeder. The weeds have to be young and at the right stage for the finger weeder to be able to pull them up, but it's a much more economical machine. Okay, so our takeaways from this project were that in 2020, we had excellent control from the Robovator, excellent weed control from the Robovator in Colusa, but we saw crop injury in Merced in 2020 and in Colusa in 2021. So those high winds, non-upright plants affected the precision of the Robovator and led to higher percent crop injury, though we did not see this translate to a loss in yield or anything towards the end of the season. Our finger weeders provided excellent control in both fields in 2020. We got over 95%, except for one plot in Colusa that had very heavy bindweed pressure, which does not get pulled up with cultivators. Matrix or rim sulfuron and the finger weeder treatments reduced costs and time for hand weeding later in the season in Merced. And then all of our treatments, so both cultivators and matrix, reduced costs in Colusa compared to the control. So as I mentioned, finger weeders are much more economical than robotic weeders. You're looking at $1,000 versus about $100,000. But there's many more automated robotic weeders being tested in California, and it's really quite a growing market. And it's exciting to see where that technology is going. Okay, so now I'm going to shift gears to processing tomato diseases. This is the main thing that I work on as a vegetable crops advisor in the Sacramento Valley. This is a table from 2016 to 2022, just fields that I was called to on farm calls and where we have confirmed disease results. I'll go through each of these diseases in more detail, except for bacterial canker, and mention some of the projects that I've done related to the fusarium diseases. You can see that I've bolded some. We have three fusarium problems, and those are kind of our main issues in the Sacramento Valley. Though in the last 2 years, beet curly top virus, second up from the bottom, has become a major issue as well. And I'll be covering that a little later. So there's many diseases that affect tomato, and they can be very hard to distinguish from each other in the field. Some look different on certain varieties. Some viruses look like fungal pathogens. So diagnosis is really key for management. So a little bit about the disease triangle. We have environment, host plant, and pathogen, and then time. So the presence and the amount of pathogen and its relationship to the host plants is very important. Some diseases affect many plants, some are specific to one crop, and others are specific to a group of related plants, like solanaceous crops, which would be tomatoes, peppers, eggplants, and potato. The environment also plays a crucial role. Diseases need different conditions to infect a plant. For example, southern blight is a crown rot and has hundreds of plant hosts, and it needs high moisture and high heat to infect plants. If it doesn't have both of those conditions, you shouldn't have a problem with it that year. Some plant diseases thrive in cold and wet conditions, while others need hot and dry conditions. And some diseases also require insect vectors to spread. So I'll start with Fusarium crown and root rot. This is becoming more common and widespread. It was very prevalent in 2021 and in 2022. In 2022, it was the most common Fusarium disease in my counties and statewide. That was diagnosed by Cassandra Sweat's lab. Cassandra is our extension plant pathologist for vegetable crops and field crops at UC Davis. So Fusarium crown and root rot causes yellowing on the margin of the oldest leaves and then necrosis. The plant will slowly decline over many weeks. Stunted and wilted older plants may die. It can also look like tomato spotted wilt virus or alfalfa mosaic virus. And one key characteristic of this disease is that the crown rot is a localized lesion. So the stem will be brown on the outside and rotten on the inside. But if you cut the plant at 6 inches or 12 inches up the stem, it will be healthy looking. So that crown rot is localized. The roots will also often be decaying. And this disease overwinters and survives for many years in the soil as a spore. And it's favored by cool soil temperatures and spread by machinery and transplants. So management is disease-free transplants and also sanitation, which is cleaning your equipment so that you're not spreading it throughout your own field or to some of your other fields. If you grow tomatoes in California or especially in the Sacramento Valley, then you know a lot about Fusarium wilt race 3. This is a big issue in the Sacramento Valley. We're very lucky now that we have resistant varieties that are pretty much widespread. So that's a very helpful cultural control for this disease. Individual branches become yellow and wilt. One of the classic symptoms of Fusarium wilt is the yellow flag effect. So you'll see one branch that's just turned completely yellow. And if you can follow that down to the stem and you slice just a little bit off the stem, you can see this vascular discoloration in that photo on the left. So that's this internal dark brown discoloration that can extend far up the stem. Fusarium wilt shows up later in the season compared to verticillium wilt, which is usually seen 45 days after planting or earlier, whereas Fusarium wilt is usually seen 45 days after planting or later. It's favored by warm weather, drought stress, and a heavy fruit load, but it can look very similar to verticillium wilt. Infected plants will usually die and it can greatly reduce yields. So you get kind of a vine collapse towards the end of the season. It overwinters and survives for many years as spores in the soil, just like Fusarium crown and root rot, and it can survive on other plants without causing them harm. It is spread by seed, transplants, and soil on machinery again, so field sanitation is very important. Management, our number one management strategy is resistant varieties for Fusarium wilt race 3, cleaning farm equipment, avoiding nematode infestations. Fusarium wilt has an interesting relationship with root knot nematodes, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a few slides. And if you can, rotating out of tomato for several years may reduce inoculum level. I know this isn't always possible for everyone when tomato is their biggest cash crop. And also we've had fields in our area that are old rice ground that had tomatoes maybe 20 years ago and then had years and years of rice. They put it back in tomato and the whole field goes down with Fusarium wilt. So rotating out doesn't always work. Sometimes it does, but that's just something to keep in mind. Our third Fusarium is Fusarium falciformi. This is a new disease that we've been dealing with that's really been spreading quickly throughout the state, especially in the Sacramento Valley. Sacramento Valley has kind of the worst issues with Fusarium compared to other parts of the state that grow processing tomatoes. So Fusarium falciformi can cause branch or whole plant chlorosis. That's when the whole plant gets very yellow or kind of looks like it's the leaves have been bleached. You can get deep leaf curling, leaf deformities, and little leaves. Leaf speckling, that leads to leaf death, and then the whole plant will die. This is first and foremost a vine decline disease. So we call this Fusarium falciformi stem and vine decline. You want to look for the foot, crown, and stem rot to differentiate this disease from other Fusariums and from virus, herbicide, or salt damage. The only consistent symptom with this disease is that foot, crown, stem rot, and the crown rot will start below the soil line. Unfortunately, also for this disease, not all foliar symptoms develop in all varieties of tomatoes. So this disease can look a lot different depending on the variety of tomato that you're growing. So we still have a lot to figure out about this disease. And I want to mention again that Fusariums and other soil-borne fungal pathogens are very hard to distinguish from each other in the field. We don't have any rapid tests to differentiate them. So diagnostics is key. And if you are in the state of California growing processing tomatoes, Cassandra Sweat's lab does free diagnostics if you go through your local farm advisor with your field or vegetable crop samples. So we've been doing a project on Fusarium falciformi for the last couple of years. This is also funded by the California Tomato Research Institute, where we've been evaluating Fusarium falciformi in variety trials to determine if the commercial varieties have any tolerance or are especially susceptible to this disease, since we don't have any resistance for it yet because it's new. And we're also scouting previously confirmed fields for whether there's infection in rotational crops. Are these rotational crops acting as alternate hosts? So I've been working with seed retailers like Ag Seeds and TSNL to evaluate their trials in fields. And we evaluate advanced decline plants for each variety, and then we get the yield data. So I shared recently in my December newsletter a variety table with data from this project. So if you would like that, you can let me know and I can send it to you. We're still working on management strategies for this disease. And this is just kind of an idea of how quickly it's been spreading. So in 2019, we confirmed it in my area in 2 tomato fields and 1 pumpkin field. 2020, 1 additional tomato field. Farm calls were a little lower in 2020 due to COVID-19. 2021, 4 more tomato fields and 1 cucumber field. And then last year, we had 8 more tomato fields that tested positive for Fusarium falciformi. So it's really growing in scope. So verticillium wilt, like I said, it can be confused with Fusarium wilt. It causes yellow V-shaped areas that narrow from the margin on the older leaves, and then the leaves will turn brown and die. You get that same vascular discoloration, that light tan discoloration in the vascular tissue near the base of the plant. So if you just scrape lightly, you'll start to see that brown discoloration. It's not going to be very deep into the stem. Older and lower leaves are usually the most effective. This disease has a very wide host range and is most notable during fruit sizing. And again, is more of an early season disease because it's favored by cool soil and temperatures. So if you're past 45 days after transplanting, it's probably not verticillium wilt, but again, diagnostics is key. This fungus survives as microsclerosia in the soil and persists indefinitely. Usually doesn't kill plants, but will reduce vigor and can reduce yield. So management again, feel like a broken record, sanitation and washing of equipment. Rotating to non-host crops like corn and small grains can also help you reduce inoculum if you're able to do those rotations. So I want to mention southern blight as well, because we had major issues with this in 2017 in Colusa, where it had never historically been a problem. Southern blight is a destructive crown rot disease. It rapidly kills tomato plants and it has over 500 plant hosts. It persists year to year in crop debris and is favored by high temperatures, high soil moisture, dense canopies, and frequent irrigation. So as I mentioned when I was talking about the disease triangle, southern blight has to have both the high temperatures and high moisture to develop. And you'll see small tan to reddish brown sclerotia form at the base of the plant or in the soil right around the plant. And you can kind of see these little beads in the top right photo. Or you can see white fan-like mycelium growing on the crown or into the soil, and you can see that on the top left. Plants will go from healthy to dead in less than a week. It's a very rapid disease, so that's another way to kind of differentiate it from other diseases. And the disease patches are roughly circular, as you can see in that bottom photo. So management for southern blight, rotating with non-host crops if possible. There aren't many since it has over 500 plant hosts, but corn, sorghum, rice, and small grains are usually a good bet for at least 2 years to reduce inoculum if you're able to do that. Deep plowing to bury plant debris may also help destroy sclerotia, and keeping the bed tops dry to help reduce the disease because it's favored by humidity. And it's, you'll see all of this right at the crown of the plant. So right where it's making contact with the soil. We conducted a monitoring project funded by California Tomato Research Institute. And I did this with Cassandra Sweat, our plant pathology specialist, where we were looking at rotational crops and southern blight. So in 2017 in the Sacramento Valley, we had very late spring rains. Tomato planting was delayed. And then all of a sudden, all of these fields had southern blight because we had that high moisture from the rains and very high heat. So because we had these issues in tomato in 2017, in 2018, we looked at those same fields and we looked at the rotational crops. So sunflower and corn, that those fields were planted to see if they were effective rotational crops for managing southern blight. We found that corn worked well. It reduced inoculum levels in the soil, but sunflower did not. And this is because sunflower is a host of southern blight. So we weren't expecting it to be an effective rotational crop. So southern blight has the potential to cause losses for specific fields in the Sacramento Valley as our growing seasons get warmer and we get more spring rains that contribute to later plantings. So we know that we have it here, but it's just not an issue every year. So it was mainly an issue in 2017. We've had it pop up in a couple fields since then, but we really haven't had that same kind of weather pattern that we had in 2017 since. But those fields that do have southern blight sclerotia in the soil, if they get those conditions, that high humidity and high heat, then they're going to have issues with southern blight again. So root knot nematodes are another major issue that we have. They cause galling of the roots. The galls then interfere with the flow of water and nutrients to the plant. The plants will yellow, wilt, and usually respond poorly to fertilizer, and they'll have a patchy distribution. So you want to check the roots of the plants mid-season or later, but if you're seeing above ground symptoms, then you can check them earlier. And the above ground symptoms are kind of just like the plants don't look good. They're just yellowing, something's wrong. So you can just dig them up and you'll see these root galls. They're very obvious. Damage is more likely in sandier soils. Managing root knot nematode, manage your weeds, use resistant varieties. We have root knot nematode resistant varieties and rotate with non-host crops. I mentioned these resistant varieties, but we're trying to understand the relationship between root knot nematode and fusarium wilt, possibly other fusariums as well, and the fact that we're getting this resistance breaking in the varieties. So we're seeing varieties that are supposed to be resistant to root knot nematode developing root knot nematode galls. And so this is poorly understood. It's usually in fields that also have a fusarium disease. So funded by California Tomato Research Institute in 2021, I worked again with Cassandra Sweat and Amanda Hodson, who's a nematologist at UC Davis. And again, root knot nematode feed on tomato roots. They affect nutrient uptake and then reduce yield. This photo on the top is an example of a field that has two different fusarium diseases and root knot nematode, and all of these plants are dead. So root knot nematodes are breaking through the resistance in these varieties. Is it because of heat events? Is it because of diseases? Or is it because of those cultivar resistance traits and just the genetics of them? So this root knot nematode fusarium complex predisposes plants to the disease and they're overcoming resistance, and that's increasing damage from both root knot nematode and from the diseases. So for example, this field here is a root knot nematode resistant variety and a fusarium wilt race 3 resistant variety, yet all the plants are dying. So what's happening? So we conducted some field trials to determine the efficacy of nematicides and fungicides to co-manage root knot nematode and fusarium wilt, and to see how the fusarium wilt resistant cultivars interacted with nematode infection. And we did find that one of the experimental fungicides that we used did help reduce the number of severely declined plants. But it wasn't replicated. So Cassandra and Amanda are continuing to look at this relationship. Okay, now I'm going to move into the two insect vector diseases that I want to cover. So beet curly top virus was never an issue up north in the northern counties. We didn't have a problem with it. It is transmitted by the beet leafhopper. Beet leafhopper is the only insect that transmits beet curly top virus. Beet leafhoppers acquire the virus from weeds in the foothills, and then they move down from the foothills into the valley each spring. They don't like tomatoes, but they feed as they migrate through and then transmit the virus. So they can't recognize a plant by sight. They have to taste it first. So they taste tomatoes, they taste cucurbits or squash, cucumber seed fields. And then they're like, oh, I don't like this, but they've already transmitted the virus, and they move on. So this has historically been more of a problem in the Central Valley, especially Fresno area. But we had an outbreak of this in 2021, and it really freaked out all of my growers. It was still prevalent in 2022, but not as damaging across the landscape, more affected to certain pockets near the foothills. So this affects our vine seed growers as well, those that grow cucumber, squash, and melon seeds. And we'll be holding some informational meetings about this in 2023, and we'll also be trapping this winter and early spring for leafhoppers close to the foothills. So beet curly top virus causes purpling, leaf curling, and premature small red fruit, and also causes stunted growth in tomatoes. I have a picture on the left of a tomato plant with curly top. It looks very different in cucurbits. You get yellowing, wilting, the leaves will turn necrotic and crispy. You'll get swollen veins and a proliferation of shoots. The other major virus for processing tomato growers is tomato spotted wilt virus. This virus is transmitted by thrips. Thrips pick up the virus from infected plants or weeds, and then they transmit it to new plants as they feed on tomatoes. So tomatoes are both a host for the virus and a host for thrips. The resistance-breaking strain was found in the Fresno area a few years ago and has become the dominant strain there. And we confirmed resistance-breaking in 2021 in Sutter and Yolo counties, found it again in 2022, and it is now the dominant strain in the Sacramento Valley as well. So it's slowly spreading. And resistance-breaking means that we have so many tomato varieties that are resistant to tomato spotted wilt virus. But now the virus is breaking that resistance, and those resistant varieties are not useful to us anymore since we have this resistance-breaking tomato spotted wilt virus. It can be confused with beet curly top virus, with alfalfa mosaic virus, with Fusarium falciformi. The foliar symptoms are very similar in Fusarium falciformi and tomato spotted wilt virus. We do have a quick test, an immunostrip quick test for tomato spotted wilt, which is really great. But to know if you have resistance breaking strain, bring the plants to your local farm advisor and they can take them to campus to have them that confirmed. Host plants include tomato, pepper, lettuce, fava bean, and radicchio. And weeds like sow thistle, prickly lettuce, and cheeseweed are also hosts. Management of tomato spotted wilt virus, planting resistant varieties, using virus and thrips-free transplants, monitoring for thrips and diseases, and applying insecticides for thrips at early stages of crop development that'll then minimize virus spread within your field, and also controlling weeds in and around the field to reduce host areas. So early infection of spotted wilt can lead to stunted growth. The leaves will curl, wilt, you get this yellowing or bronzing, and you might get necrotic spots or rings on the leaves. So the initial symptoms are leaf bronzing and wilting, and then you get necrotic leaf spotting and some vein, stem, or petiole necrosis. Plants can look crumpled. And then one of the characteristic symptoms is the ring spots on the fruit. Okay, so before we move on to melons, I just want to mention that this was published, our pest management strategic plan for California processing tomatoes was published in summer 2021. This is a planning document detailing pest management issues and management practices in a particular crop, in this case, processing tomatoes, with input directly from stakeholders. So we have statewide critical needs, we have northern region critical needs, and we have southern region critical needs for processing tomatoes. It's essentially a needs assessment. It also documents all the current pest management strategies and lists priority research, regulatory, and education needs for California processing tomatoes. So if you would like to look at this, it's a great, very all-inclusive document, and you can find this at the Western IPM Center in their documents for PMSPs. Okay, so I'll wrap up with a little bit on insect issues and fresh market melons. The number one issue is cucumber beetle, but there's loopers and melon aphid and many more issues like whiteflies, darkling beetle, and flea beetle. But the cucumber beetle is the biggest issue for Sacramento Valley melon growers. Whiteflies and loopers aren't really an issue every year, and the melon aphid is usually a late season issue and can be difficult to control. So monitoring is key. If you want more information on insect issues and fresh market melons, you can look at the UCIPM pest management guidelines for cucurbits. So loopers are caterpillars with a narrow white stripe along each side and several narrow lines down their back. They arch their back as they crawl. Adult moths have a brown mottled forewings marked in the center with a small silver figure eight. They feed on the underside of leaves, skeletonizing them. In high populations, they may feed on the fruit surface as well. Generally, your predators, your natural enemies, can keep them under damaging levels as long as you don't spray out any of your beneficial insects. And like I said, pressure varies year to year. The melon aphid or cotton aphid, most of my calls related to melon aphid are usually on pumpkin. They prefer the underside of leaves. They are not deterred by high temperatures like some other aphids, which is why they're more of a late season problem. They have an extensive host range that includes cucurbit, citrus, and cotton. Host weeds include milkweed, jimsonweed, pigweed, and field bindweed. Their feeding will distort and curl leaves, and they can also produce large amounts of honeydew, which then leads to sooty mold. They range in color from yellow-green to pink and black. They're a major problem on young plants, especially when they feed on the tips of runners or in the growing points. They can also vector cucumber mosaic, zucchini yellows, and watermelon mosaic virus. That can cause loss of vigor, stunting, and even death of the plants. So there's no threshold that's been established for melon aphid. If large numbers do build up in parts of your field early in the season and appear to be stunting growth or causing a lot of honeydew buildup on the fruit, you can apply an insecticide kind of as a spot treatment to the infested portions of the field rather than having to apply it to the whole field. Preserving habitat for beneficial insects and predators around the field and keeping dust down will encourage predation and parasitism. There's actually a picture of a mummy aphid here that's been parasitized in this photo. It's kind of that big bloated beige colored one. So natural enemies will help keep the melon aphid under control until late in the season if the populations aren't too severe, because this insect is difficult to control with insecticides. Okay, so we'll finish up with cucumber beetle. The western striped cucumber beetle is the number one pest of musk melons in the Sacramento Valley. Melon is its preferred host. It has multiple generations per year. Difficult to control with insecticides because it hides underneath the fruit. So adults are the biggest issue. They are very damaging to seedlings, and to their fruit feeding causes scarring and then leads to unmarketable fruit. So they appear to overwinter in leaf litter and in weeds adjacent to the melon fields. We also have the western spotted cucumber beetle. This beetle feeds on foliage, flowers, and fruit, but remains in the plant canopy, which makes it easier to control with insecticides. And the spotted cucumber beetle overwinters in other crops like alfalfa and corn, and then migrates into the melon fields in the spring. Current management for cucumber beetles: fields are regularly scouted for beetles, and conventional control relies almost exclusively on insecticides when beetles are detected. Applications are repeated as needed throughout the season to avoid crop injury. This could be once a month, or it could even be weekly in high pressure years. Sprays are focused on the seedling stage and then flowering to fruit development. Fruit are softer and more vulnerable to scarring damage when they're developing. And these are also major pests for organic cucurbit producers, especially because they don't have that chemical control to rely on. The general idea from pest control advisors in my area is you see one striped beetle, you spray the field, a handful of spotted beetles, you spray the field. And this is because the male cucumber beetles release an aggregation pheromone that then draws more beetles to the scene. And so it can seem like you have one or two beetles, and then overnight you'll have many more. So usually if they see one striped, they spray, because striped are such a major issue for damage to melons. So I've been doing cucumber beetle research for the past 4 years with Dr. Ian Grettenberger. He's our cooperative extension specialist for entomology in field and vegetable crops, and our work was supported by the California Melon Research Board. We have been trying to develop tools to better monitor and manage cucumber beetles in melons. We've done this with a pheromone trial and a non-crop habitat trial. So with the pheromone, we were evaluating the efficacy and attractiveness of vitatolactone, which is the male aggregation pheromone for the eastern species of the striped cucumber beetle. So we were looking at it for the western striped cucumber beetle. And we determined that the aggregation pheromone is actually the same for both species. They're very closely related. This was developed by USDA on the East Coast. So we used the pheromone. We tested it at two organic farms in the Sacramento Valley. And what we have in this photo here on the left is we have three panels of our sticky cards. And on the far right, you can see our control sticky card. And then in the middle is the pheromone. And then we have the pheromone and the floral lure on the far left. And so you can see the pheromone, we caught more beetles than the control. And then when we added a floral lure to the pheromone, we caught significantly more beetles. And this was definitely a late season effect. So we didn't see this kind of captures during the season because the beetles are still preferring the melons and the cucurbits in the field rather than the pheromone on the sticky card. But in the late season, when there are no cucurbits in the field, we're seeing this effect of the pheromone with the floral lure. So we're hoping to use this in kind of an attract and kill strategy down the road. One of the other things we looked at was, where are the striped beetles overwintering? These areas could then be targeted for monitoring or management prior to or immediately after cucurbit plantings. So what we were doing is trying to characterize this non-crop habitat and observe the feeding behavior. And this is because western striped cucumber beetles feed exclusively on cucurbits throughout the crop season. But because of the timing of melon plantings in the Sacramento Valley, which is May through July, the beetles require nourishment before their preferred host is available, and they have to feed on something to survive. So the temperatures start to warm in February, and we know the beetles are becoming active, but we're not planting melons till May. So Technically, they would normally want to survive and reproduce on wild cucurbits, but these are not widespread in our field margins in the Sacramento Valley. So we found that they were mainly hanging out on milk thistle and mallow, but that they will only feed, that they readily feed on milk thistle and brassicas, but they would not feed on mallow in some lab studies that were done by Jasmine Ramirez, who is Ian's graduate student. So very interesting. Now we know we can target some of these areas for control of cucumber beetles. We've also conducted multiple insecticide trials, and I just want to talk about this one that we did in 2022 quickly. So we looked at acetamiprid, which is a sale. This is one of the number one conventional insecticides used. It's very effective at killing and controlling cucumber beetles. So we combined this with Sidetrack L from Trace A, and this is a gustatory stimulant. So it's a feeding stimulant. And when mixed with an insecticide, it encourages the beetle to eat more and ingest more of the insecticide. And we paired Sidetrack with a sale at the full rate and a sale at the quarter rate. And what we found was, and then we also did tested an experimental insecticide in doxicarb, which is called Avant. It's not registered in California on melons, but it showed a lot of success against the corn rootworm in the Midwest. And the corn rootworm is closely related to the cucumber beetle. And what we found was all of the Asale treatments, so just our acetamiprid foliar, acetamiprid quarter rate plus Sidetrack, and acetamiprid full rate plus Sidetrack, were very successful at killing striped cucumber beetles compared to our untreated control. And we'll be testing this again in 2023. So we also rated the scarring severity in each of our treatments, where a zero was an acceptable melon with hardly any scarring, and a five was very extensive damage that blends together, and it just kind of increases from there. But anything rated a one through five would be considered a cull and not acceptable because it had too much scarring damage. And with that, on the left are the damage ratings for the different treatments. And the portions of this stacked bar represent the average proportion of melons that fit within the category. So the damage ratings go from zero undamaged to five completely scarred. And you can see that with a quarter rate of the insecticide plus Sidetrack, that feeding stimulant, we didn't get any melons in the three, four, or five category of scarring. So it's very effective at reducing scarring damage, which is great because if growers can use less of an insecticide combined with the Sidetrack, they can get the same efficacy as full rate. That's really exciting news. So we're looking forward to doing more on this in 2023. And then on the right, this is the number of undamaged melons from each treatment. So the accepted melons. And again, all of our Asale treatments fared much better than our control and the experimental. So I want to conclude by saying that Sidetrack paired with Asale looked very promising, even with the reduced rate of the insecticide. And we're looking forward to diving into this and focusing more on this relationship in 2023. And in the long term, we hope that improved IPM practices, including monitoring and targeted management, will help prevent and suppress damage by cucumber beetles. They'll likely remain problematic pests because there's very low thresholds for damage in conventional melon systems. They can have very high populations, and there's a very low amount of tools for organic growers to use. So we're working to improve IPM in melons for cucumber beetle. And with that, I want to thank you all so much for listening. I know I covered a lot of topics. If you are in the Sacramento Valley or just interested in vegetable crops, you can subscribe to my newsletter for research updates and local pest information. And that's my email there. If you have anything you want to follow up on, you can email me.
Thank you, Amber.
Yeah.
We do have a couple of questions. We have a final test coming up, but since we have a few minutes, I'm going to go ahead and ask you those questions. So one of them came in the chat, and this one was, what is your opinion of the use of TerraClean 5 for soil diseases and doses per acre?
I have never heard of TerraClean 5, so I don't know. It's never come up with my growers or PCAs or any of the specialists that I work with as an option for soil diseases and doses. So I'm not very familiar with that. So I'm sorry.
The next one in Q&A, and if anybody does have any questions, go ahead and put them in the Q&A. We have a few minutes. This next question is, would mallow be a suitable trap crop? Would the beetles being attracted to it but not feeding reduce population growth?
I would say it's probably not a suitable trap crop. So in the fields we were doing the non-crop habitat study, they were organic fields because cucumber beetles get sprayed out in conventional fields. We couldn't really use those for our monitoring. And it happened that the most prominent weeds in those sites were milk thistle and mallow. So we don't know if that's why the beetles were there, just because those were the weeds available. But them not feeding on it would just push them to other things they can feed on. So it wouldn't be, they wouldn't really be starving. They still don't really have to eat a lot because they're not quite overwintering, but they're not fully moving around yet either. So I don't think it would be a very effective trap crop.
All right. Thank you. And then another one in the chat, a question about Fusarium falciforme, seeing as it appears to be widespread, do you think it's actually new or if something has changed in its favor, making it more aggressive?
So this is a really interesting question because we're trying to learn a lot about this disease, and I'm not a pathologist or a pathology taxonomist. And so even Dr. Cassandra Sweat's having some issues with this. It used to be Fusarium salani and has now kind of become much more aggressive. And the naming has kind of, all this nomenclature for taxonomy and stuff has all changed. So it has become more aggressive, and it used to be referred to as Fusarium salani, which was, the growers kind of referred to it as Fusarium foot rot. So it's very similar to that. There's a lot of different like subspecies within Fusarium falciforme. It's very confusing even when Cassandra tries to explain it to us veg crops advisors, and then we try to explain it to our growers.
Okay, there's another one here for you. I noticed that tilling is both assumed and recommended for field preparation and suppression of fungus and nematodes in tomatoes and melons. Is there any research into no-till or low-till methods? And then anecdotally, they have eliminated these issues in home scale plots.
Yeah, so I'm part of a project looking at no-till in organic vegetable fields, but not necessarily related to pest management, more related to soil health. So I don't know of any research into no-till or low-till methods for controlling these soil-borne fungal pathogens. I do have an organic grower in my counties who's been building his soil health for the past 25 years using controlled traffic farming, not quite no-till, but very shallow till just in the seed line. And he has very low disease pressure. So that's just kind of an anecdote there.
And then there's a comment in the Q&A saying, reach out to Dr. Robert Hutmaker. He has a lot of knowledge with Fusarium work on cotton and tomatoes.
Thank you. Yeah, we've been working on Fusarium and tomatoes for a long time. I've been in this position for 7 years. And Cassandra Sweat, it's pretty much all her lab does is work on all the Fusarium diseases. And we're really interested on why Fusarium crown and root rot has become the most common Fusarium disease we're diagnosing, when in the past it was always Fusarium wilt. So that's something she's looking into as well.
All right. And then we'll just take another one or two questions, I think, and then we'll get to the few final wrap-up things and the test. For the root knot nematodes, is it Melodogyne incognita? They are known for breaking Fusarium resistance in cotton.
Yes, that is the species that we're coming across the most. Amanda Hodson at UC Davis, our nematologist, has all of the species data for the collections we did in that project where we were looking at fungicides and nematicides as well. She collected a lot of root nematodes and identified them to species, and that was the majority was Melodogyne incognita.
All right. And then this one final one that's in the Q&A, are you open to some research with OMRI, bionematicide with zero entry interval?
Yeah, I'd want to know more about it. So if you want, you can send me an email and we can talk about that offline.
Thank you, Amber, for presenting today. I enjoyed your presentation.
Thank you.
All right. So we're going to go ahead and close out. So thank you so much, everybody. And we hope to see you at our next one on March 22nd. Have a great afternoon.